Hello, and welcome back for some more Torment, Tides of Numenera. I'm the RPG chick, still recovering from some laryngitis. My voice normally sounds better. This guy is awesome looking. I can't zoom in anymore. What does it all mean? So let's talk to this guy again. Oh, he's joined us. Okay, so here's his portrait, Tybir.
Yeah.
So, wait, that's me. I'm like, how'd he end up with an eight-fingered mace? He has a broadsword. Typical sword has a few notches, scars earned from long years of use. He has a shield. Meant to be strapped to the arm, this simple wooden shield will offer some limited protection by absorbing incoming blows and projectiles. Tybir Sark cannot be unequipped, only usable by Tybir. This loose-fitting shirt belongs to Tybir. It offers limited protection, but it makes him look dashing and roguish. And that's what really matters, at least to him. A cloak? Same. Tybir's cloak is finely made of high quality and remarkably colorful cloth. It has numerous small tools sewn into hidden pockets in case he needs them in a pinch. Okay. So he's agreed to stay on with us to, you know, help us look at the city, and he wants us to do this quest for his friend. He can hold one cipher. He has 22 hit points. I wonder, though, Cagey Jack, who knows how to take care of himself. Tybir has a talent for juggling words, and it's difficult to pin him down to any particular truth. It's like we can't trust anybody in this game. Tybir hasn't lived this long without learning how to survive, even if it's sometimes at others' expense. And you can read about Jax if you want to pause the video. Go ahead now. Wondering if he's going to stay with us after we help him with his quest. That would be pretty cool. I don't know if I've read this. Kalastasia's ability to exist in multiple realities at once gives her a unique outlook on things. She's gathered esoteries and knowledge from countless realities. She's truly a force to be reckoned with. You are studious and know a great deal of information about many things. You have few social graces, however. So wait. -1 in deception skill, yet we still manage to deceive Koro, is his name, instead of, rather than getting a fight with him. He must be really, naive. Oh, this is some good tea, man. Tazo tea. It's got, like, passion fruit and like, hibiscus herb in it. It's awesome. I highly recommend. It's helping my throat a lot. My throat doesn't hurt, but it helps my voice. So... hold on, a character sheet. So he's got Elocutioner. I'm not going to read all this. Everyone in the party finds it much easier to talk their way out of problems. Okay, so this helps party members gain. Alright, good. So we'll be better at deceiving people, since we were horrible at it. I wonder if she has that. Allegern might have. I don't even know. Sucker Punch? Why fight fair? Take advantage of your opponents whenever you can. You know they'd do the same to you if the situation were reversed. I like the graphic. Faint. Tybir lunges, forcing his enemies to flinch away from a blow that never lands, and leaving them open to devastating follow-up attacks. When an enemy fails to resist, confer fainted. The next attack that hits this character deals weapon damage +4. Cool. Sounds like someone's breathing very loudly. Flex skill. Your mercurial temperament can occasionally be a hindrance, but when you focus on a skill, you are without parallel. That must be really useful for Jax, who, like, basically jack of all trades, but if they focus on one thing, they're really good at it. A chain, a hook, and an unbalanced enemy. That's all you need to ruin someone's day. You throw a chain around your target and drag your foe stumbling within range of your attacks. Snare a target with a grappling hook and pull them towards you. Now, does the grappling hook come from this ability? Because he doesn't actually own a grappling hook. So maybe he conjures into effect a grappling hook? I don't even know. Let's see if we can... What else we can talk to him about?
Thanks for taking me on, lass. Always good to have a friend watching your back. Hmm? Now, what can I do for you?
He sounds like a nobleman. Tell me about yourself. Sure. What's your story? Oh, the usual. Farm boy joins one war or another. He doesn't die, but gets a sound spanking by the world until he learns to spank it back. I want to hear more about your background. And I don't blame you, he declares, clapping you on the shoulder. But I'll warn you, I've never had a handle on what people consider too much information. His smile crinkles the corners of his eyes. Never look for one either. He claps his hands. Go on, ask your questions. I've got answers for everyone. Tell me about your life as a soldier. Well, I wasn't the best or the worst, he says with a shrug, but I started at the bottom, fell out the side, and ended up a gallows class on my own. It's not an easy life, being a mercenary, but you try to fight for causes you believe in, and avoid striking blows that aren't deserved. And you try not to fail at both, while the realities of life batter you into new shapes, change you. He thinks, some of the best days of my life, those, despite the tears. You said that the realities of life changed you. How? Not one for the light questions, are you? He rubs his hands together. My father raised me to be honest. Well, honesty works on a farm. Animals don't lie to you much, as a rule. But as a soldier... He squints. Put it like this. First night in the camp, I was mugged by my sergeant and left for dead. All because I thought an honest face meant an honest heart. He thinks it's the honest ones you have to watch out for. So I've adapted my approach over the years. I reward kindness with kindness, cruelty with justice, and foolishness with object lessons on the ways of the world. He winks, but there is something somber there. Everyone has their lessons to learn in this life. Best that your teachers are kind men, I always say. Who have you fought for? Whew, he says with a misty look on the air. I've fought for a number of causes over the years. My first fight was alongside the rugged cattlemen of the plowshares, trying to keep the slave families of the Sagas Protectorate from getting their hands on the bird folks' grazing land. He shrugs. But I've been all over the map, and off the edges too, having good times and bad. Went with the Ailu rebels, the White Company, even fought in the endless battle for a while, until I figured out my commander was lying to me. Walked away from the hefty purse on that one, I'll tell you. But it was the right thing to do, he winks, and the safest, and the sanest. He thinks, should have left even earlier, pay or no pay. Can you tell me about the endless battle? Sounds like Warhammer 40K. Of course I can, he says, but for a moment it seems he won't. His mouth works, but no words come out. It was more a nightmare than a war, he says at last. We marched out one morning to take a certain hill, and we took it. You know what it also reminds me of? The battle between the demons and the devils. I forget what it's called exactly. But it's the battle that the Nameless One, well, depending on which ending you choose, he, you know, goes back and joins the war. The Blood War? Something like that. It's against the demons and devils. The devils are lawful evil, and the demons are chaotic evil. And they can't abide the differences in each other. So he winces. Then a shivery little ripple crossed the battlefield. And we were back on the march, headed for the same hill, only this time the other side routed us. I lost this arm. He shows it to you, smooth and unmarked. You'd think our commander would have given us the rest of the war off, but no. I guess he got his arm back. His eyes go hard and grim. She kept making us fight until the waves of time died down, and we took that damn hill and held it. He smiles wearily. I'm certain I died a few times myself, but here I am still, whole and handsome as ever. What's the point of the endless battle? The fighting itself is pointless. All those lads and lasses dying for a cause centuries old? He smirks sadly, his gaze distant. Now, I know I just described any war, but we both know that certain people make a tidy profit from bloodshed on a grand scale. And the endless battle? Well, it's endless, and that makes it endlessly profitable. I want to hear a story from your past. You do? He says, taken aback, but he recovers quickly. Of course you do, he says, and strokes his mustache. Which part? Huh. So he has some kind of false confidence. He is not as self-assured as he puts off. This, of course you do, and stroking his mustache, that's an act. It's the first response that is often the most telling. How about one of those good times you mentioned? Oh, I've had plenty, he says, running his teeth over his lip. More good times than bad. Even as a gallows glass, but of course there is one that stands out. But he isn't smiling now, despite his words. My partner at the time, my old sergeant, and I heard of a scrap brewing on the border between two mercenary armies over territory. He scratches his mustache. We got there and knew it was going to be a bloodbath the moment someone went for a weapon. They'd been rivals for too long, see? It's a sad, sad thing to go see professional killers turn violent. Now, I was thinking we should get back on the road and as far from the fight as possible, but my partner, he was a tinkerer. A soft gleam rises in his eyes. He had these two rings he was messing with at the time. Claimed they could link minds. He wanted to plant one in each side, you know. Get them seeing things from others' point of view. I couldn't talk him out of it. He snuck around in the dark of night, cursing and thumping. Set up the damn things in the rival camps and ran back to our distant hill to watch. He rubs his eyes. And all night long we heard strange things. Sort of wet sounds, you know? Laughter. Happy sighing. He runs his hands to his hair. Then dawn came, and there was a different kind of war going on in the mud below. He flashes a grin. The kind where everyone wins. Huh? Turns out that once they got a taste of each other's thoughts, they found out they hadn't wanted to fight each other after all. Not exactly. And that was obvious for you. He finishes with a touch of a smile. Always bringing out the truth in people. He thinks, a better man than I deserve, certainly. Who's Avi? Huh? He eyes. He says, sorry, eyebrows climbing. Oh, let his name slip, did I? Arvin was the old sergeant I mentioned. First we were partners, then more than that by a long shot. Oh, really? He sinks his thumbs beneath his belt. But, well, you know things. They change. Grinning, Tybir shakes his head. Huh. I haven't thought about the man in years. He thinks. Ah, that's why I haven't thought about him. Too hard. Huh. Tell me about your first battle. Huh. He says. I nearly missed it. As I said, my sergeant knocked me out, stripped me naked, and hit the road with his friends and all the best weapons and armor and stolen wagon. He clucks his tongue fondly. I woke up with a throbbing head and blood in my eyes to the new sergeant screaming that I'd best throw on a sack and grab a stick because the protectorate was coming. I can't recall much about the battle itself. Lots of screaming, and most of it mine. I remember hitting a number of heads with that stick, and I lost a sack at some point. No one seemed prepared to comment, what with all the dying. At any rate, the Protectorate kicked our teeth in and drove us back to a little herd, a little herd town at the far eastern side of the eastern end of the Plowshares. He winces at the memory. Well, the herd folk there, they were doing all they could for us, feeding us, binding our wounds, because, well, we'd been defending their town, hadn't we? He spreads his hands, trying to at any rate, but they didn't know that the Protectorate had also stolen all their anine for provisions, the whole herd, and was headed south with them. I guess these are animals, anine. He sighs. Come winter, those folk were going to starve to death. He thinks, how the herd got stolen is a different tale. Villains on all sides we were. He shifts, uncomfortable. My commander wasn't going to tell him, but I couldn't stand it. We were meant to be the saving of these people, but here we were robbing them just as surely as the Protectorate had. So that night, the new sergeant and I borrowed two rasters and a sonic punch and flew south until we found the stolen anine. We screamed dived the herd until they bolted and chased them all the way back north. He shakes his head. He thinks, what a young hero I was. What a fool. We nearly got knocked out of the sky a dozen times by their fire throwers, but we were sure that once we got the anine away, they wouldn't dare turn back for them. They knew we were being reinforced the next morning, you see. Avi got demoted for that stunt, and we both got a week in the brig besides. But those herd folk were damn grateful. He winks. Some of them, several times. I want to hear about some of your mercenary work. Too many stories in that sack to tell in a single sitting, he says, scratching his head. But I'll stick to the one with the least amount of back-alley murders. It's too lovely a day for grim tales of bloodshed. He squints at the air. It was just after I'd left the military life. I was desperate to make a name for myself as a mercenary. Too desperate, as it turned out. Well, I had no idea we'd spend so much time just talking to this guy. This is insane. I was drinking in my favorite bar and felt a soft touch on my shoulder. It was a lady, Navarine nobility, she said, and in need of a bodyguard. He covers his eyes, and that body, those eyes, I accepted on the spot, of course. She tried telling me why she needed me, something about assassins at a ball, but I was too busy watching her hips shift beneath that dress. Okay. So he's avoiding labels he's attracted to men and women. I followed her around that ball with barely a thought in my head. Then, halfway through the party, she excuses herself and comes back in different clothes. He chuckles, though there's no humor in it. She tells me that to anyone who asks, I'm her husband, Baron Giosk of Navarine, and that we have to leave immediately. We worked our way toward the door, but we were stopped by the host of the ball and a phalanx of city guards, and they demanded to know who I was. Grimaces. Terrified, but right on cue, I say, I am Baron Nikusk. Nikusk? I thought it was Nyusk. Oh, he's wrong name. Giosk. I am Baron Nikusk of Gavraline, and this is my knife. He shakes his head. 30 days in the blocks as an accessory. Turns out she'd stolen a fortune in living gems from the upstairs bedroom. She wasn't in any kind of noble, just a common, beautiful thief. He thinks, and the next time I saw her, she was dead. Life isn't fair for anyone, and that's the truth. Who's Arvine again? I want to hear her. My old sergeant, partner and lover, couldn't tell you where he is now. So you're a captain. Retired, he says, raising his hands in surrender. I've been on my own, more or less, for a handful of decades now. He winks. Still, having a captaincy under your belt opens doors, lifts dresses, and drops trousers, so I tend to wave it around whenever I can. more about your background? No. What are your strengths? Well, he says, planting his hands on his hips, I can hold my own in a fight. I have a gift for words, as you may have noticed. His hands slip from his hips and cross before him. And I'm not averse to the odd coin or two if you spot one worth pulling. What are you doing in Sagus Cliffs? He clears his throat. Well, until this mess with Riss, at any rate. Now, I guess I'm looking for work, adventure, new opportunities. I want to talk about the people we're traveling with. Gossip and backbiting, is it? I'm always game for that. Who do you want to talk about? Calistash. I met her once before she diversified. Lovely woman, but I'm not sure if more is better in this case. Calistash says, well, do inform us when you reach a conclusion, darling. My sisters and I yearn for the opinions of aging criminals. Depend on it, dear lady. That's so funny. Of course they can hear you. She can hear you. What do you want from me? You know what I want? I want you to help me save Riss before he's crushed to death. Yeah, I knew that. How are you holding up? Never better, he says, his face a friendly mask. Don't you worry. I'm with you to the end. He thinks, the end of my path anyway. But she's been useful so far. I haven't been useful. All I've been doing is asking you questions. Alright. No, I don't suppose. Let me just see what he says. As always, the Levy is smiling broadly. He nods to you. Hello again, visitor. How can I assist? I'd like to go up on the platform. I am privileged to inform you that you cannot. The Levy manages to make it sound like a piece of excellent news. If you wish to discuss the matter further, please direct your inquiry to the official in charge. He points to the indigo-clad man on the projecting edge of the dais. Farewell. Alright, let's talk to Yin the Overseer. A stout, middle-aged man stands atop the execution platform. He wears the badge of a city official, and a fringe of dreadlocks hangs down to his shoulders from his otherwise bald pate. He gives you a disinterested look as you approach. Please stay back with the others. What's going on here? He casts a brief glance over his shoulder towards Riss. The prisoner, Riss of Flatwater, is being publicly executed as a warning to all who would flout the laws of Sagus Cliffs. What's his crime? Treason. He sold state secrets to the enemies of Sagus Cliffs. How does the execution work? Another rustic. It is very simple, ma'am. Our nanos induce in him an hallucinogenic state. In this state, he experiences visions. Nightmares, really. He speaks of the things he sees, and his words become flesh as they leave his mouth. We shape the flesh into a human-like form, the death you see beside him. He gestures toward the hideous figure, which looks to be made of rotting viscera, whatever you say that. As more strands escape his mouth, his death wraps them around him, and they slowly crush the life out of him. Once the condemned is dead, the devourer of wrongs will eat his corpse. He raises his chin, proud. Thus is justice upheld in Sagus Cliffs. What do his words mean? He shrugs. Some believe there is wisdom to be gained from the rantings of the condemned. I have never gleaned any. Others say that the torment of the condemned means nothing, but it deters would-be criminals from committing offenses of their own. I have never noticed that to be true either. Why does the devourer of wrongs eat executed criminals? He smiles, grim. He is of the Dendra O'Hur, who can suck the memories of the dead from their marrow. In those memories is not only the proof that the condemned were guilty, but also the names of their companions and other associates. Many an accomplice has been found out in the belly of the Devourer. He thinks, I'm sure Riss wasn't working alone. We'll find all his friends soon enough. He's standing right here with us. What would it take to free Riss? He laughs and sobers quickly. The only thing that could free him would be a pardon from the Council. And for a luckless nobody like this, that's about as likely as me growing wings. Who are you? He bows slightly. I am Yin, overseer of the of capital punishment, charged by the Council with organizing public executions and making sure they run smoothly. I want to talk to Riss. He snorts. Impossible. No one speaks to the condemned. It's against the rules. Oh my god, he's my father. I'm not even going to try that. Bribery, though? I don't think that's wise either. I really feel that both of these would be a bad idea, guys. Good day. We can't go up. Yes, everything will be washed away. But nothing too. Devourer of Wrongs. I can't actually talk to them. And we shall live in the bones of a behemoth, buried in a lake of flame. Someone to do something. Alright. Watch how fast I can run. Okay. Fine. We're sealed jars of air here, humid or dry, savoring and refreshing. Okay, let's look around the rest of this place. It's gonna take us like multiple episodes just to... Yeah. Explore this whole place. I ate one of those ones. Give me the Chamblers for weeks. Let's talk to Kellinor. Is there anything to look at here? Jars of air. Let's talk to Kellinor. Can we stay 10 more minutes? Padja. This couple stands together, their shared gaze fixed away from you. No words pass between them. Instead, they share a silent language of tenderness. Their bodies turn subtly towards each other, forming a private space between them. His hand reaches for hers, and without looking, she claims it. Still looking past you, they smile together. His is a curving line carved in oak, hers as unabashed and radiant as a lantern on a starless night. I guess this is she thinks he's so beautiful. I do hope we're a good home for him. We're a good home. Is she talking about the kid? Is that their kid? Turning, you see the object of their attention, yes. A young boy darting between the stalls and playing in the dust. Each distant, exhilarated shout widens their respective smiles and tightens their grip on each other. Oh, they're like really in love here. Is that your son? Yes, Kellinor says firmly. He's still watching the boy, but a wary stillness has spilled into his posture. He's protecting him. Padja swats his shoulder and is more punched than playfulness in it. Not yet, she says. We adopted Jherem, and we're waiting to see how he feels about that, aren't we, Kellinor? His eyes flicker stubbornly, but he does not respond. He thinks, go away. Go away. To us, I guess? This is a touchy subject. What brings you here? Jherem likes it, Kellinor says. The stern expression around his stern eyes softens somewhat. There's very stern stuff going on in this sentence. Padja says, we don't have much time between shifts or money to spend on fripperies, so we bring him to the market when we can, and watch him play. It's better than a night at the theater. Kellinor raises their clasped hands and kisses her bruised knuckles. Are her knuckles bruised because she punched him that hard? Okay, they're not going to like this. Why did you decide to adopt? Well, Kellinor and I, we've been together for... how long? Years, Kellinor says, a glint in his eye. But he thinks, let's see how long this one lasts. Oh, boy. This is not genuine between them. At least it's not reciprocated on his part. Although he's, you know, obviously putting up a good front. Padre says, and we knew we wanted children, so we tried and tried. We tried a lot. Some days I barely had time to put my clothes on before Kel took them off again. Interesting. Go on. She raises her eyebrows but continues. Well, there was poor Kel, practically falling asleep on the shift, forgetting his trousers half the time, and me with nothing to show for it but a glow on my cheeks. Clearly we were working with a barren field. Or faulty seeds, Kellinor adds, deadpan. Does run in the family. So we decided to find a child who needed a home, rather than getting old trying to make one of our own. That answer your question? I'm gonna need... why do I need more details? I wouldn't realistically say this, so more than adequately. I thought so, she says with a wide grin. A wide grin. We get asked this question a lot, and finally we found that being explicit about the process made the questions just melt away. Jherem likes it. Padre says simply, so we do too. Enjoy the market. Dried virulent meat, fresh from quarantine smokehouses in the bloom. So, yeah, they speak as one.
Of course.
Broken Dreams on sale, 5 for a shin. I'm gonna talk to this kid. The kid skids to a halt and rubs his forehead with a grimy forearm, leaving arrow tracks of dirt across his ruddy skin. Hey, Shuva, he pants, shading his eyes from the sun and grinning up at you. Never seen you before. You call me Shuva. What does that mean? Huh? Jherem says. A cautious light enters his eyes. Really? You never heard it? And he thinks, has that changed too? I don't know. I feel like lying. It sounds familiar. What does it mean again? Relief flashes across the child's face. Okay, so he wouldn't fully trust us if we said no, I guess. It's a nickname for adults. Not a mean one. Not really. Some adults are nice to kids, right? Pat the head. Here's a flower. A bit of Nash. Whatever. But some aren't so nice. They curse. They shove us aside when we're in the way. Kids remember moving... kids remember shoving more than smiles, right? So, Shuva. He thinks good. At least some things are the same. The same as what? Do you like playing in the market? Not always, but it's better than school, hey? And I like watching Zayofi make sculptures. The ones that go sharp and curly. Reminds me of the monster on the side of Scarra Hall. Scarra Hall? What's that, a building? Yeah, Shuva, Jherem says, chuckling. It's just a building at the center of town, 1,000 hands tall with a mural on the side, like Zayofi's sculpture, but flat and in purple rock. Don't think you're going to miss it if you're looking for it, hey? We might, Calistez whispers, studying Jherem with something like concern. The Scarra Hall was a grand temple at the center of town. Like the child says, I say was because it was torn down centuries ago. I do hope he's lying, because otherwise he's mad. Or they come from a different time or something, and they're wondering what's changed between their time and now? Shuva being one of them, he was wondering about. Tell me about Scarra Hall again. Yeah. Why are you so dirty? I don't know. Padre and Kellinor make me wash twice a day. Guess the dirt likes me, hey? Don't your parents worry about you running around here alone? My parents? Jherem says, eyebrows crinkling. You mean Paja and Kelinor? They're watching me until my Mard and Ciro come back for me. What do Mard and Ciro mean, mother and father? Huh? Jherem says, looking just as puzzled as if you'd asked him what hands are for. Mard, Ciro, my parents. You asked me about them. Paja and Kelinor are taking care of me until they come back. He thinks, that's another one, isn't it? No wonder Paja doesn't like me talking to people. Wariness steals over Jerem's expression, and he bites his lip, as though he fears he has said too much, and is trying to hold the rest of his words in. You keep using words I don't recognize. Where did you hear them? His face goes white. I'm not allowed to tell adults about that, or about where I'm from. His gaze steals to Paja and Kelinor, both of whom are suddenly taking a greater interest in your conversation. Don't ask, hey? He thinks I'm in so much trouble. I'm not even sure what I did. Oh, I hate to see this, Tybir says, raising his eyes to the sky. Such a bright and promising lad, and he's already keeping terrible secrets from his elders. What? Jherem says, squinting up at him. No, it's not like that. It's nothing rancid. I just promised I'd stay quiet, right? Tybir gives you a barely perceptible jerk of his chin, urging you on. He's right, Jherem. You shouldn't be ashamed of the truth. Tybir nods solemn agreement. You can't help noticing that he looks somewhat ashamed. Jherem wavers, looking between his adopted parents and the two of you. Finally, he gives up. All right, I guess I can tell you. But you can't spread it around, right? All right, tell me about where you're from. Some, like, 2,000 years in the past or something, right? Here, Shuva, he says, brow crinkling in frustration. I'm from here. It just up and changed without me. I grew up in the Downs. My parents lost their spots on the work chain, and we went to sleep hungry more and more. Neither of them could look at me without crying. He swallows. But everyone in the Downs was starving. Wasn't anything new. People started using that archway more and more. He pauses, scanning your face. He thinks, the Downs have changed too. I can see it on her face. What are the Downs? Oh boy. My blue tide went up a bit more. I forget which one that is. I have silver and blue, so I'm a little more blue. Jherem sighs. If you weren't in the families in the up, everywhere else was Downs, inside the wreckage. We dug deep, looking for food first, warm second. My neighborhood was inside this curvy spiral. If you've ever seen paintings of a seashell, it's like that. He thinks, I knew it. What is wrong with this place? Tell me about that archway you mentioned. Big thing. Always good smells coming out of it, too. Like roasting meat and sunny days. I used to watch it, but I was never sure what it was for, you know? And the parents in the Downs never talked about it, either. He shrugs without looking at you. Then one morning I saw Corna, a friend of mine, and her Mard go up. Mard gives her a kiss, sends her through, and Corna never came out again. Know what did, though? Now, I'm guessing he's not talking about the arch that we passed through. With those worms or whatever on top. It's supposed to be something else. Bloody bones. I don't want to tell him that. Music. Close, Shuva. He says, lovely guess. But no, it was a metal ring. He says, lowering his voice to a confidential whisper. Didn't look to be worth much, but every once in a while you'd hear Corma laughing. Wherever she was happy, right? He raises his hand to his cheek, then continues. Handful of days pass, and my Mara takes me for a walk, too. Says she'd find me when they'd save the money. Kissed me and pushed me through it. Woke up outside another archway, up in Government Square. Padja and Kellinor were waiting for me there. He rubs his nose. They're not so bad, but I keep hoping my parents will stop by to visit. Even if they don't have the money yet, right? He pauses, rubbing at the sudden moisture in his eyes. I try to laugh a lot so they can hear me, though. Wow. They threw him, and then they get a ring. And then they do what? Pawn the ring for money? Story didn't get any shorter since the last time you asked. Jherem says, sure you want to hear it? Give me the short version. My Mar didn't want me to starve, so she pushed me through an archway. I landed outside another one, where Padja and Kellinor were waiting. They're taking care of me until my Mar and Ciro come. Wow. Cheers, Shuva. At your turn, Padja and Kellinor tense, but do not look away from Jerem's adventures in the marketplace. Jherem told me about the door he went through to get here. What's going on? Had the pride in you, Kellinor growls. Calm down, Kel, Padja says, putting her hand on his chest. Stranger, can we convince you to leave this alone? Please, for the sake of our family. She thinks, if Jherem finds out, I'm terrified to think what will happen. I just want to know what's going on here. I won't tell anyone. Blue tie went up more. She bites her lip and searches your eyes. Kellinor's hand slides over her shoulder to cup the back of her neck. Kellinor says, maybe you're true to your word, and maybe you're not. The more we argue, Padja hisses, the more likely Jherem will overhear. Her eyes shift to you, weary and despairing. Jherem got here through the House of Empty Time. He comes from Sagas, like us, only centuries in the past. That's why his speech is different, why he remembers places that aren't here anymore. She jabs your chest with a calloused finger. Keep this to yourself. We'll tell him ourselves when we find a kind way of letting a child know that everyone he knows and loves is long dead and dust. She thinks, I'll kick the skist out of her if she breaks my little boy's heart. There's really no sense in telling him. I mean, what good would it serve? Right? He does deserve to know the truth. Maybe when he's older? Not choosing this. Not choosing lie. I won't be the one to tell him. But you should. And soon. Gold tide raised a small amount. You're right, Padja says. And we will, I promise. Tell me more about the House of Empty Time. We don't know any more than we told you, she says, shrugging. Find the house's keeper and ask her. Her name was... She trails off, forehead creased in thought. Alcyn Perry, Kellinor says. Keeper of the House of Empty Time. You might find her in Government Square. Thank you, Cal. I couldn't hold on to a name if it was buried in a bag of shins, Padja says cheerfully. Anyway, the very moment we decided to adopt, she was knocking on our door. We were nervous, but you can't argue with the results. She beams past you at Jherem. Farewell. Enjoy the market. Wow. We buy and sell used memories here. Well, we'll check out these merchants next time, guys. Extra long episode. Dried virulent meat, you know. Headaches and migraines of all sizes and severities. They got all kinds of cool stuff. Thanks for watching, guys. See you in the next episode. And endure. In enduring, grow strong.